Once you've identified some prospective end users you want to study, you could start asking the following questions to characterize them. They fall into three broad categories: demographics, motivation, and behavior. Demographic questions would be questions such as the following: what's their gender? What's their age range? What's their income range? What's their geographic location? Questions about motivation are: what motivates them? What do they fear most in the world? Who's their hero? Questions about behavior are: where do they go for vacation? Where do they go for dinner? Where do they go before work? What newspapers do they read? What websites? What TV shows do they watch? What are their watering holes? Because you don't want to have to go find these people up in the woods, because that's really hard. You want to find them down at their watering holes. That's much more efficient. Ultimately, in all of these, you're looking to find out what makes them special and identifiable and deselects other people, so that if you see a potential candidate, you can say it fits within this our end user profile or it doesn't. And it shouldn't be so broad that everyone you see fits in that profile. Remember, this is not a complete list, nor do these criteria apply in all situations. You need to customize this for your situation. But let me tell you, this will give you a good start. More likely, your process will be iterative. With each new end user interview, you will learn new and important questions to ask other people, and you'll get a more and more refined end user profile.
How did you identify the first people to learn more about the problem and then eventually to test your prototypes?
Yes, so the first, it started observing my friend who's visually impaired, how he interact with the watch he was wearing, you know, either the talking watch or the analog, the tactile analog watch. And then I was curious enough to ask, you know, if they cannot see the watches they're wearing, you know, how do they tell time? I mean, this is called watch. Maybe because you have to watch this to know the time.
So when you were talking to your friend who has poor eyesight, what questions did you ask him? You mentioned that you asked him about the kinds of watches that he has. What else did you ask about? What else were you curious about?
Yes, so I mean, first I noticed that the watch that he was wearing was just really bad looking. So I asked him, so do you like your watch? And he said, no. And he said he oftentimes even preferred not wearing a watch when he dresses up, because he knows that in this talking watch, it just looks really cheap and bad. You know, he doesn't. So he oftentimes, when he dresses up, he prefers getting lost to know what time it is than looking bad by wearing that.
And that's incredible.
Yes, so in the beginning, it was a lot of cold emails. So basically just Googling, you know, the blind community or organizations that serve the blind. I randomly contacted people through LinkedIn and Facebook and Twitters. So if you go into the LinkedIn, you can, based on the job descriptions and their locations and their photos, you can kind of tell how old they are, where they are located, you know, their occupations, and even sometimes their kind of the sense of styles. And I sent them the same message to all of them saying, hey, here's our product. It's a fashion timepiece that you don't have to look at to tell time.
You began speaking earlier about reaching out to centers that work with people who are visually impaired. So continue the thought.
So I had a big list, a long list of organizations that serve the blind. And I basically emailed them, I called them. And in the beginning, the response rate was pretty low, which I understand, because I only had the concept in mind. I didn't have a physical actual prototype to show them. And most of the organizations, the big organizations, they get tons of calls and emails from people like me, you know, to ask for a partnership and for user feedback sessions. And so it was really hard to get their attention. So we started with a really small self-organized organizations. So one of the organizations was Vibug, visually impaired and blind user groups. They meet every once a month in people who are visually impaired living in the Massachusetts area. So their members are, each meeting they have about 40 to 50 members coming in. Most of them are visually impaired, but they have some members who are not visually impaired, like me. And they were really more, very, very supportive in terms of, you know, taking their time for me to do the user feedback sessions. Most of the products, when they develop the prototype, they have nice images, you know, 3D images and graphics. So they just show it to, you know, a group of people all at once, and then they receive the feedbacks, the written feedbacks. But since our target audience was those who are visually impaired, none of those images or written descriptions, none of them worked. So the only way I could get feedback from them was to make a physical prototype like this and bring it to them one by one. You know, presenting this in front of a group, it doesn't work even. So I literally have to go, you know, knock on the door, you know, to meet with them individually. And I mean, one meeting, it takes about 1 hour. So I did, I think I've met about close to 100 people who are visually impaired. And I made a whole bunch of these so that, you know, I can pass around, you know, 10 of these all at the same time. And so I collect their feedbacks, and even if I make a really slight improvements in these iterations, I have to make another whole set of physical prototypes. And again, do the whole thing over and over again, bringing the new iterations to them and say, hey, is this what you meant with your feedback? Is this the correct designs that you wanted? We went through more than 50 iterations.
This persistence, this patience, these iterations, this dedication to truly listening to your end users creates the foundation that you will need to achieve a breakthrough like Hyung Soo.
The first thing that I found out from talking with many different blind user groups is that they care a lot about, you know, the designs and fashions and the styles of the products they use or wear. And that's something that the stereotype that I had towards them was they would not care about the design so much as long as it works well for them. I was totally wrong. I felt very ignorant after I found out. One of the first questions they asked in most of the user group meetings was about the size and the style, the design, even the colors, because they're equally conscious of about the styles of what they wear and what they use. And I think, if I think about it now, why would they not be, you know, caring about the designs or the styles of what they use or wear?
Now, mm-hmm. if people are visually impaired, mm-hmm. how can they perceive the style of something? How can they perceive mm-hmm. the color of something? And mm-hmm. and how does that become important to them?
Yes. I mean, they interact with all different people. You know, they don't live with blind community only. You know, the families are mostly sighted, and they have friends who are sighted. They have teachers, and some of them, you know, a lot of them, they work full time. Their coworkers are sighted, so I mean, their daily conversation is the same. You know, having a friend who is visually impaired, you know, in your dinner table, it doesn't mean that your conversation is going to change just because of him. You know, you have the same daily conversations. He's part of it, so he or she has really good sense of, you know, what's hot, or, you know, the following the trend.
Let me tell you a product that I use often. I go to Legal Seafoods. It's a restaurant right here in Kendall Square next to MIT. I love Legal Seafoods. It's a place that's very friendly when I get there. The maitre d' is always saying hello. They always have a good table for me. They know I want to do business at lunch. I want to talk to important people. I can go there every day. There's great variety of food, and it's healthy. And when people come in from out of town, they love to go to Legal Seafoods because it's a place that's quintessentially Boston. So if I think about that, I can build an end user profile of people like myself that want to go to Legal Seafood. I will, in fact, pay a premium to go to Legal Seafood because I want not just the food, but I want the whole package, the whole solution. And when they do such a good job as they do, I tell other people about it and I go back there. That's why I'm a frequent customer of Legal Seafood, and I'm a powerful end user profile for their business. Now let's do an exercise. Think about a product that you buy often and ask yourself, why? What makes you buy this product? Now what you're going to do is build an end user profile of yourself. Describe yourself in detail. Focus on factors that you think contribute strongly to the reasons why you buy this product. Think of others like yourself who would buy the same product. Do they fit in a homogeneous group with you? That would be an end user profile.